Hello everybody. So in today's video we'll be checking out what are those incompletely specified functions and how do you simplify them. So first of all, we need to know what do you mean by this incompletely specified functions. Incompletely specified functions are those functions which very commonly you people call it as don't care conditions. So the same don't care conditions which are indicated by X in the logic design or in the digital circuit or in the digital electronics is called as incompletely specified functions. Why do we call it as incompletely specified functions? Because you do not know what will be the value of that, or those functions do not have any specified values. You can have any values. You can have the value of them to be a zero, or you can have the value of them to be one. No matter whatever value you are going to give to it, it is not going to make so much of difference. So this is what incompletely specified functions means. So to get a very good definition regarding this incompletely specified functions, it actually means the output of a function which doesn't get altered with the changes in the input. No matter whatever changes you are going to do with the input, my output is going to remain the same. My output is not going to get changed. If the output is going to be, or if the output is zero, no matter you change your input, my output will still remain zero. Or if the output is one, no matter you change the input to any values, my output is still going to remain one. So this is what is incompletely specified function. Now, if such incompletely specified functions are given to you people, how do you solve them? Or how do you actually look into that? So that is what we are going to check in this particular today's video. So let's check. As I said you, when I speak about all this particular Quinn-McCluskey method or Petrick's method or K-map method, we have only 5% of theory and the remaining 95% will be all about numericals. And the understanding of this particular topic will be a lot better if we take some examples and if we start solving them. So in order to understand this, we'll be taking an example as it is given here. The question reads, find the minimum sum of product for the function f of ABCD, which is equal to summation m 2, 3, 7, 9, 11 and 13 with the addition of don't care conditions of 1, 10 and 15. So when these don't care conditions are given to you, how do you solve them using a Quinn-McCluskey method is all about today's video. So normally the don't care conditions when they are given to you, you people need not do anything special here. You just consider this particular don't care conditions. The don't care conditions, whatever we are having here, you consider them to be the normal conditions along with the normal function. I mean to say, I can rewrite this as summation m 2, 1, comma, that is 1, comma, 2, comma, 3, comma, 5, comma, 7, comma, 9, comma, 10, comma, 11, comma, 13. So this is what you are going to do as an initial step. The don't care conditions are considered to be the normal conditions and you are going to write the truth table for them. Once you write the truth table for them, we'll be going on with the normal Quinn-McCluskey method, whatever we had followed in the earlier videos or in the earlier sessions. So when this particular video is given, or when the particular don't care conditions are given to you people, you are going to write a truth, or you are going to consider them to be a normal function, and you are going to write a truth table for them. And after writing a truth table, you are going to pick up the functions which has got a variable values to be something like 0000 or 0001 or 0010 or 0011. All those values are picked up and they are grouped into a group which is containing all four zeros, one ones, two ones, three ones and all the four ones. As of now, my function starts with one. I do not have a variable which will be containing all four zeros. So that is why I'll be starting with a element which contains one ones. So here one and two will be containing one ones, which is grouped as group one. Next, I'll be going on with the group two, or you can call it as you can call this as group 0, you can call this as group 1. In group 1, I'll be having the numbers which contains 2 ones. In group 3, I'll be containing the numbers which are containing 3 ones. And in group 4, I'll be containing the numbers which are containing 4 ones. Once they are been grouped very properly, our next task in the Quinn-McCluskey method is all about comparing them. You need to compare the elements of the group 0 with group 1. And group 1 element should be compared with group 2. And group 2 element should be compared with group 3. So I'll start with my comparison of group 0 element with group 1. Once I go on with the comparison, I will be comparing 1 and 3. When 1 and 3 are compared, I'll be getting it as 1, 3, which is nothing but 0, 0. That is 0 remains 0, 0 remains 0, 0 has changed to 1, which should be indicated by a dash mark, and 1 remains 1, because of which I'll be getting 0, 0, -1. Similarly, I need to compare my first element of group 0 with second element of group 1. So once I compare them, I'll be getting 1, 9, which is -0, 0, 1. It is not that all the elements will get compared with all the elements of the other group. You need to check whether it is comparable. And this comparable or comparison happens only if there is change in one particular position of a digit. That is, check out here. 1 and 3 got compared. 1 and 9 got compared. 1 and 10 I cannot compare, because when I compare 1 and 10, you can see 0 has changed to 1. 0 is remaining 0. 0 has changed to 1, which means there is change in 2 position. Again, 1 has changed to 0, which means there is change in 3 position. The comparison can happen, and you can write the result only if there is change in one particular position. So 1 and 10 cannot be compared, because of which you can see here 1 and 10 are not compared, and I have not written the result here. Similarly, I need to take the second element of my group 0 and compare it with the elements of the group 1, and I'll be getting something like 2, 3 and 2, 10. 2 and 9 cannot be compared, probably because there are change in 3 positions. So if there is change in more than one position, you cannot compare them. So that finishes my first group of my second stage or second column. And you should not forget to put a tick mark in front of the numbers which is already compared. This is very important. So here 1 has been compared with 3. So 1 and 3 has been put a tick mark. 1 and 9 has been compared. So you'll put a tick mark in front of 9. 2 and 3 has been compared. So you'll put a tick mark in front of 2. And 2 and 10 are compared. So you'll put a tick mark in front of 10. Which means these numbers are compared. What is the next step? The next step is comparison of your group 1 elements with the group 2 elements. When I compare group 2 elements, group 1 element with the group 2 elements, you can see it will be saying 3, 7 gets compared. 3, 7 gets compared means I need to put a tick mark in front of 3 and 7, which results in -0, 1, 1. Again, I'll be having 3, 11. Again, I'll be having 9, 13. I'll be having 9, 11. I'll be having 10, 11 getting compared. So here that much comparisons will happen, which will be resulting in this particular group 2 elements of column 2 or stage 2. After that, you will start comparing group 2 elements of column 1 with group 3 elements of column 1. So there you will be getting 7, 15, 11, 15 and 13, 15. That finishes off my task of the second column. That is, comparison of the first column is done and you are already ready with the second column. Your next task is to start your comparison of the second column elements or the separate group elements of the second column with the other one. That is group 0, group 1 and group 2. So when I compare my group 0 with group 1, I'll be getting 1, 3, 9, 11. Only these are comparable, because of which my result will be -0, -1. You should be a very good observer. If you do not observe it very neatly, you are going to miss out something. So I'll put a tick mark in front of 1, 3, 9 and 11. Then again, probably 1, 9 and 3, 11 gets compared. It will get compared, because it is dash remains dash here, 0 remains 0 here, 0 has changed to 1 and 1 remains 1. But already you have written 1, 3, 9 and 11. You need not write it down once again. The numbers might be coming up in a jumbled form, but if those numbers are going to get repeated, you are not going to write it again. So which will be reducing your work. The next group will be 2, 3, which will be getting compared with 10, 11. So when you compare 2, 3 and 10, 11, your result will be -0, 1. First group 0 with group 1 will be done. Coming on to group 1 with group 2. When you compare group 1 with group 2, you will be having a comparison happening between 3, 7, 11, 15, which will be giving me -11. And again, it will be 9, 11, 13, 15, which will be giving me a result of 1-1. So if you check it very properly, all the groups here, all the elements of the group get compared with all the elements of the other group. That is why I can see a tick mark here. I can see the tick mark in front of everything, because of which none of the elements from here will become my prime implicants. As all the numbers are getting compared here, I will not have any prime implicants here. The resulting thing, what you have written in the column 3, will be your prime implicants. So this prime implicants here are, I can say it is B-D, B-C, B-D and A-C. So these are your prime implicants after comparison. So what is your next task? Your work is to reduce the given function. So, in order to reduce this particular function, I need to write a table of essential prime implicants, what I am going to do now. So, please concentrate. The elements, whatever I have written here, are the prime implicants. I need to pick the essential ones from that. Those are called as essential prime implicants, which will be your ultimate, finalized, simplified function. So, here, this is my table of the essential prime implicants. You can check all the numbers, 1, 3, 9, 11, 2, 3, 10, 2, 3, 10, 11. All the numbers has been written here, 3, 7, 11, 15, 9, 11, 13, 15. All the 4 prime implicants has been written here, so that I'll be able to pick up which is the essential ones in that. So in front of B-D, I'll put a tick mark in front of the number 1, I'll put a tick mark in front of the number 3, in front of number 9 and in front of 11. Very similar to B-C, I'll be putting a tick mark in front of 2, 3, 10 and 11. Very similarly for CD, which is a prime implicant, I'll be putting a tick mark in front of these numbers 3, 7, 11 and 15. For AD, I'll be putting a tick mark in front of 9, 11, 13 and 15. 9, 11, 13 and 15. As I said in the very previous class, always when you take up the prime implicant and when you are writing the table for essential prime implicants and when you are going to write the very finalized function, pick up the first function. Normally, my first function will be a essential prime implicant. That is why I have written my first function as such. B-D has been written as such. Coming to the next function, B-C, I'll check whether it gets repeated anywhere. So here when you check up, you can see that B-C has numbers 2, 3, 10 and 11. 2 is not repeated somewhere in the previous. 3 has already repeated. 10 has not repeated anywhere in the previous thing. Similarly, 11 has repeated in the previous things. Just because this 2 and 10 are not repeating anywhere, I should be taking my B-C to be also a part of the essential prime implicant. In case if it was, if this was not 2, let me say this is not 2 here, this is 1 and this was somewhere 9. That is, I mean to say that it would be 1, 3, 9 and 11. Then you need not write B-C, because all the numbers are repeated in the previous stage. Coming to the next thing, CD. When it comes to CD, the numbers are 3, 7, 11 and 15. 3 and 11 are repeated in the previous stages, whereas 11 and 15 are not repeated in the previous stages. Whereas when I come to the next stage, this 15 is going to get repeated. So this one is not going to get repeated in any of the stages, because of which my CD will also be a part of the essential prime implicant. Coming to the next one, which is AD. AD is 9, 11, 13 and 15. 9 is repeated, 11 is repeated, 15 is repeated, but 13 is not repeated anywhere, because of which I need to be writing AD to be also a essential prime implicant. So whatever prime implicants you had here, none of them got eliminated, because of which my prime implicants and essential prime implicants remains the same.
It is not necessary that they cannot be same. Sometimes they can be same. But most of the times, at least one or two functions here or one or two elements here will get eliminated, reducing the function. So, this is your essential prime implicant. In case you say that, sir, I am not able to look into this or I am having confusions regarding picking which one to be picked up and which one not to be picked up, fine, no issues. You go on with the Petrick's method, what we studied in the previous class, and Petrick's method is going to give you an ultimate simplified solution to this particular function. So, this is all about incompletely specified functions, which is very similar to your Quinn-McCluskey method until and unless they give you a don't care condition. So, don't care condition is given to you people just to confuse you. That don't care condition has got nothing to do in the real work with respect to my incompletely specified functions. Incompletely specified functions are considered as specified functions, and considering them to be a specified function, you will go ahead with the solving procedure.